And now for something completely different.
It's 3 a.m. Milan Bertoza is closing up his small recording studio in a neighborhood near Honolulu. Then something happens that will change the course of his career as a music producer forever.
And the phone rings, and there's a client of mine. He said, I've got Israel Kamakawiwo'ole here. He said, well, he wants to come and record a demo. Well, shutting down, come back tomorrow. And he said, no, here, talk to Israel. So he puts Israel on the phone. And he's this really sweet man. He's well-mannered, just kind, and, you know, please can I come in? I got this idea.
Charmed by the man's personality, Bertoza relents and gives Israel 15 minutes to get there. Fairly soon, there's a knock at the studio door. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's take a step back, shall we? If someone were to ask you what the first movie ever made in color was, what would you say? Think about it for a second. Did you say 1908's A Visit to the Seaside? It's fairly unlikely unless you're an insufferable film nerd like me. Okay, maybe that's cheating though, since A Visit to the Seaside is technically a short film, just 8 minutes long. How about the first color feature-length film? That would be 1914's The World, the Flesh, and the Devil. Still not your answer? Makes sense. Likely, one movie came to mind when I asked that question. 1939's classic movie musical, The Wizard of Oz, based on L. Frank Baum's novel, The Wonderful Wizard of Oz. While Wizard of Oz may not be the first color film, it certainly has its place in film history. It's an iconic, visually pleasing, well-acted, and well-told story, which was a beloved box office and critical hit when it first released, receiving 6 Oscar nominations, including one for Best Picture, and winning 2 of them. It was re-released several times before the rise of television, where it was constantly aired on CBS, solidifying its legacy as a film classic. Both of the Oscars Wizard of Oz won were related to its music, with the first being for Best Score and the second being for Best Original Song, which was rewarded to perhaps the movie's most iconic number, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. Which almost didn't make it into the film. During the last stages of production, executives at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, or MGM, the production company behind Wizard of Oz, felt that the iconic number slowed the movie down too much and pushed for it to be removed from the final cut. Infuriated, associate producer Arthur Freed stepped in, telling studio head Louis B. Mayer that either the song stayed or he would leave the production. Mayer relented, saying,
"Now let the boys have the damn song. Put it back in the picture. It can't hurt."
It definitely didn't, with the song becoming a long-standing cultural touchstone, being voted the greatest song of the 20th century by the National Endowment for the Arts and the Recording Industry Association of America in 2001. Somewhere Over the Rainbow already had some quite meaningful roots before it ever was put to screen. It was originally created by Yip Harburg, born Isidore Hochberg, and Harold Arlen, born Chaim Arluck. Both first-generation Jewish Americans, the children of Jewish immigrants escaping the rising anti-Semitism in Europe. A sentiment that was still very much rising in 1939, if you can recall. The two wrote the piece while drawing from their family's experiences of wishing for and escaping to a land that they only imagined in their dreams. While the piece was composed by Arlen and written by Harburg, what most people remember is the performance by the actress Judy Garland. The song has a wistful and longing quality that clearly has touched people, but it also had a special meaning for Garland. Judy Garland did not have the best life. Born Frances Ethel Gum, the girl was forced into performing at an early age, with her theatrical debut being at just 2.5 years old. Due to a turbulent and often abusive family life, Garland once said that the only time she felt wanted was when she was performing, and the misfortune continued into her later career. Among other things, the then 17-year-old girl was forced to work long hours and was encouraged to take diet and sleeping pills to maintain a specific figure, a move which nearly killed her and worsened her substance abuse problems, which would eventually be the cause of her untimely death in 1969. She was just 47. Somewhere. Needless to say, Garland had a grim life, and so Over the Rainbow had a very important meaning, with her once describing it as her anthem, performing it for the rest of her life. She always sang it somewhat differently, changing the tempo timbre, rhythm, phrasing, diction, and choice of pitches, and so it truly became her song. It was the most popular song she ever sang, and what many people remember her for. And perhaps it brought comfort to a tortured actress, a lifelong victim of the entertainment industry. We can only speculate.
Birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, oh why can't I?
Louis Armstrong was a remarkable musician, not only because of his work, but because of the time period which within he was famous. Growing up as a black man living in poverty during the early 20th century, he was able to develop a talent for music, specifically the trumpet and singing, and achieve great fame for his solo and band performances of the, at the time, developing musical genres of jazz and rhythm and blues. He not only wrote and performed music most of the time, but he also experimented and helped develop swing music and superior trumpet techniques that are still used to this day. His career wasn't only limited to playing the trumpet or blues, though. He went on tour with big bands, covered songs by Hoagie Carmichael, Irving Berlin, and Duke Ellington, among others, and developed new melodical techniques to accompany them. He wasn't even limited to strictly live musical performances, being featured on television, radio, and in movies. His legacy was wide, helping popularize jazz and making a great impact on music as a whole, inspiring and influencing contemporary musicians like Bing Crosby and Billie Holiday, as well as generations of musicians afterwards. However, perhaps one of his most popular performances today was not a hit during his lifetime. During the late 1960s, the world was still in the midst of the civil rights movement and had been for almost two decades. During Black American struggles for human rights, there was intense interracial conflict. The moral crimes committed against Black Americans by white opponents during that time are too many to list here, and you likely have heard many of them already. Needless to say, there was a lot of social and racial unrest in the country, and Louis Armstrong wanted to help quell some of that. Thus, he, with the help of jazz producer Bob Thiel and songwriter George David Weiss, created the song What a Wonderful World, with the hope that its optimism and celebration of life would be a beacon of light in such trying times.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
However, due to a lack of promotion in the US, the piece didn't have much impact or popularity in the States, despite its popularity in other countries. In fact, it didn't find popularity in the US until 1988, long after Armstrong's death, when its inclusion in the film Good Morning Vietnam shot it to the top 40s charts. It has since had widespread influence and acclaim, being inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame in 1999. But it didn't have the specific social impact Armstrong and co. were hoping for, despite its success. Even so, it was an inspiration for many, and perhaps it did have an impact somewhere.
Pretty in the sky, or also on the faces of people going by.
Milan Bertozza is not as famous a name as Judy Garland or Louis Armstrong. That is not the only difference either. Bertozza is also not a US-born citizen. He was born in Yugoslavia in 1962, only moving to Chicago at the age of 7, when his family was fleeing the Soviet occupation of his home country. He also was not a musician. He did earn a bachelor's degree in communications with an emphasis on recording and sound engineering when he attended Columbia College, and he trained with Malcolm Chisholm, the legendary chief engineer at Chess Records, but he himself never created his own music. Not that he'd ever released, anyway. What he did do was help other people make music. He worked with some of the industry's top engineers before moving to Hawaii in 1988, where he opened a small recording studio in Honolulu called Audio Resources Hawaii. This put him in the position to work with some Hawaiian music legends like the Kauai Crater Boys, Teresa Bright, and Don Ho. He went on to win 4 Ngā Kioku Hanohana Awards for his talent in sound/music engineering, but the thing he is most famous for is the story this video has been leading up to. A story Bertozza has a key part in. Said story really begins on that night in 1988. Bertozza had received a call from his client and Israel and given him 15 minutes. There was that knock at the door.
And in walks like the largest human being I had seen in my life.
Israel was indeed a large human being. The native Hawaiian had suffered from obesity his entire life, at one point weighing 757 pounds. They had someone from the studio bring a large steel chair for him to sit on.
I put up some microphones, do a quick sound check, roll tape, and the first thing he does is Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
More specifically, he played a mashup song, Somewhere Over the Rainbow and What a Wonderful World, all with just his voice and a ukulele.
He played and sang, and one take, and it was over. The next day, I got Israel a copy and filed the tape away.
The large man in the studio was called Israel Kamakawiwo'ole, also known as Iz, or Brudda Iz. He was born in Honolulu in 1959 and grew up in the island Oahu, which to this day remains the only island with a 100% Hawaiian population, and cannot be visited without an invitation from a resident. He grew up with his grandparents and became very in touch with his native Hawaiian heritage. He still had a finger on the vein of wider musical culture, however, through his uncle, Mo Keel. Keel was a musician and successful actor, starring as Detective Trokiolaha in the original version of the CBS cop drama Hawaii 5-0. Israel was encouraged to pursue music, and many who surrounded him loved to hear him perform. His childhood friend, Del Beasley, recalls when he first heard Iz sing at a graduation party.
They set up with instruments that were kind of beat up. In fact, one of the ukuleles was held together with bubblegum. What happened was, as soon as Israel Kamakawiwo'ole opened his mouth and sang, that whole place went quiet. Every great singer has something special about him. And that thing just cut right through the air and, you know, just stopped everybody in their tracks.
Iz would go on to have a very successful solo music career after the spur-of-the-moment recording session that night in 88, but that recording of Somewhere Over the Rainbow / Wonderful World wouldn't see the light of day for another 5 years. While a version of the song would be featured on his first solo album, Kua Anoe, it was not until 1993, when Bertoza and Iz were recording his second album, Facing Future, that they remembered the recording of the song. It ended up on the album, and then Facing Future became the most successful Hawaiian album of all time, primarily due to the song's popularity. And what popularity the song had indeed. It took over the world, appearing in commercials, movies like 50 First Dates, and TV shows like Scrubs. It became one of the only covers that, in many ways, changed the legacy of the original songs forever. And that legacy is something that was important to Iz. Iz was not only a musician, but an activist. He championed Hawaiian sovereignty and was always saddened by the colonization and effects of tourism on the lands. His song, Hawaii 78, is about these feelings, telling the story of Hawaiian ancestors looking at the state of the islands now and feeling disappointed. He had an incredible impact on the people of the islands, and so it was felt deeply when, in 1997, he passed away. He had suffered from his obesity his whole life, and he always knew that his life would be a shortened one because of it. It was a painful day in Hawaii when he passed due to complications with his weight when he was just 38 years old. The flags on the island were all flown at half-mast the day his death was announced. He was cremated, and his ashes were carried along the coast in a traditional Hawaiian voyaging canoe. Del Beasley and music producer John DeMello were two of the passengers.
And going down the coastline, all the big semi-trucks on the island of Oahu had their air horns blowing. And from the ocean, we could hear the echo, the bounce off the mountain ranges.
In the old days, people would wail when the mo'i or the king passed away and cry. And that's really what it was. I mean, this whole island came together just to say goodbye to this one Hawaiian. He would have laughed, but I tell you that right now, he would have been laughing.
Much like Judy Garland, Israel Kamakawiwo'ole's music was hopeful, despite the struggles he faced in his life. And much like Armstrong, he found great, varied success, though he was ultimately unsuccessful in achieving his social justice goals with his music. The fight for Hawaiian sovereignty continues to this day, but he is still remembered as an icon, not only to the people of Hawaii, but to the world. And who knows? Perhaps he's out there in a wonderful world of his own, somewhere over the rainbow, playing along. Way up high.